尊敬的各位来宾，会议即将开始，请您尽快入座。欢迎来到分论坛高端对话，2019年日本教育及教育科技趋势，有请嘉宾上台。Welcome to the High Level Talks on Japanese Education and EdTech Trends in 2019 Subforum. Let's welcome our speakers onto the stage.
Good morning, everyone. This session is International Innovation Subforum, Tradition and Innovation High-Level Talks on Japanese Education and EdTech Trends. My name is Nori. I am the Executive Vice President of a company called EduLab. So today, our goal is to highlight some of the EdTech trends and what is fueling these trends in Japan.So anyone who are interested in entering into Japanese market in terms of EdTech or having a global innovation, please do contact us after this session. So we have today two very important guest speakers who will also be joining our panel. One associate from an Obunsha Ventures. Obunsha is a very historical and prominenteducational publisher in Japan. So today, we would like to hear from him about why such an old educational company is setting up its own company venture capital and tackling this EdTech trend in Japan. And also, we have a guest speaker from JETRO. JETRO stands for Japan External Trade Organization, and he represents the Beijing office. And today, we see JETRO working closely with the Ministry of Economy, Trade, and Industry in Japan to promote China-Japan industry collaborations as well as open innovations. So let me start up the session with teeing up the EdTech trends in Japan. So before explaining aboutThe Japan EdTech, this is our company, EduLab. EduLab basically is a prominent assessment company in Japan. When I say assessment, most of our clients are like Ministry of Education. We do national assessments, OECD, PISA, PIAC. We provide solutions for largest English aptitude test. So we are basically an assessment company. And nowadays,Because assessment is so closely fabricated to learning, we are also a learning providing company. Our mission is to tackle education in a scientific manner. So this is EduLab. We went IPO last year, December. So less than a year. So we consider ourselves as an EdTech company in Japan. And not only we provide assessments and learning in Japan, we do investments across the globe. For example, these are some of the investments that we have invested so far. Maybe if you are a Chinese citizen, you may have heard of a company called CodeMonkey. We were one of the initial investors to CodeMonkey.And successfully was bought by Tao. Now, getting into the actual topic, let's look at the Japan market in terms of comparison to the global market. This shows an education market size in Japan and its growth. Japan, here, other areas and countries.You can immediately see what's going on. In terms of education market, Japanese market has not grown significantly. It's basically the same. So as you can see, this is a very, very mature education market. This is a market growth in terms of EdTech. This was education. This is EdTech. Japan, compared to the United States, which is the largest EdTech market today in the world, is much, much smaller. But we do enjoy a certain amount of growth. We are expecting from 2015 to 2020, 1.5 multiples in terms of growth in the market size. And this is a breakdown in terms of annual compound growth of the EdTech market. The world is about 12%. China, of course, is really, really accelerating at 18%, and US 9%, and Japan expected to be 8%, which is currently $1.64 billion market to, in about next year, $2.4 billion market. So the numbers of EdTech companies in Japan, registered in Japan, is roughly about 250 to 300 EdTech companies. But you need to be careful about these numbers because these EdTech companies are not only startups. One unique part of Japanese EdTech startup is some of the startups are like an open innovation project within a large company. For example, let's say Nikkei, the owner of Financial Times, in its own company, has an open innovation project that tackles EdTech. So these numbers include those companies as well. And what is fueling the Japanese growth in terms of EdTech? Again, 8% annual compound growth. So there is four major ministries in Japan that talks about EdTech. And if you're in the education space, you all agree that when the government say, hey, we have a policy about EdTech, you know, there's going to be a huge movement. So let me explain one by one. First of all, the Cabinet Office, the government of Japan, they have launched a future investment strategy 2018, last year, saying that we need to shift to society 5.0 and data-driven society by using EdTech. So basically what they're saying is we promote EdTech in general. And also, not to forget, Ministry of Education, very important. They also came up with a policy last year saying Education Promotion Master Plan. It's a third term. Basically what it's saying is, hey, we need to give a PC per student. And also, Future Schools and EdTech Study Group Policy, Proposal Version 1, saying that there's a lot of burden for teachers in school. So how do we efficientize these burden by use of EdTech? Now, going to the Ministry of Economy, Trade, and Industry, again last year, came out with a new policy called Future Academy and EdTech Research Group. First proposal was last year. Basically, they are saying, because they are the most closest to the business industry, they are saying, we need to solve real-life solutions. We need to have active learning, project-based, adaptive personalized learning, and STEAM projects. So these are the policies that they've made. And lastly, Minister of Internal Affairs and Communications, they deal with wireless connections and, you know, basically networks. So they came up with a plan saying that schools need to have a network infrastructure that supports EdTech. So as you can see, all these four ministries, they have different policies, but they all use the common term, EdTech. Another thing that is fueling Japanese EdTech is next year, not only Olympic in Tokyo, but in terms of EdTech, there's going to be a huge, huge movement in Japan. So I've listed some of the movements here. One is there's going to be a college entrance exam revisions. English is going to be like four skills, essay type items more. And so if you're in the English EdTech solution industry, probably you'll be yay here in Japan. And also coding and admission offices, non-cognitive skills, and digital textbooks. And MEXT and METI announced policy proposal regarding EdTech. So you've already seen that in four pillars of the explanation that I did. And what Japan is faced with today is that we are a declining population country. So how do we compete outside of world, outside of Japan? And this is what we need to do. We need to really think about re-innovating our education and coming out with a very good outcome. Let me just go first. So basically, MEXT, METI, Cabinet Office, Miyake is the Internal Affairs, which deals with wireless network. Basically, what they are saying in a nutshell is here. We need to have and prepare for AI developed society. We need to apply EdTech. And how do we tackle personal optimized learning? Liquidity of learning, you know, not only schools, but outside of schools. How do we consider this by use of EdTech? Diversification and change in teacher roles. How do we efficientize the administrative work by using EdTech? Change in school system, collaboration, innovation, change maker, innovative human resources, STEMs, STEAMs, that includes, of course, programming and information literacy, and infrastructure preparation is a key factor. So, please look to the east. Next year is gonna be very important in terms of EdTech in Japan, and also Olympics is coming. So, thank you. That's the overview of the Japanese EdTech trend.
So hello everyone. I'm Toshiki Miyake from Obunsha Ventures, principal working as a venture capitalist. I'd like to introduce we Obunsha Ventures, and I would like to present the very very simple framework to understand edutech industry. So and this is today's table of contents. The one is who we Obunsha Ventures are, and the second one is what EdTech is from our view. So let's move on to who we Obunsha Ventures are. Obunsha is, as Wada-san explained, the education publisher in Japan, which has a very long history, 88 years old, is history. And this is Obunsha mission statement written by Yoshio Akao, our founder. This calligraphy said that in English, to translate, have a big dream, take roots on the ground, provide good books, develop talents, create cultures, and prosper. I think this is the very fundamental concept, maybe through not only educational industry and also edutech. And then this is the history of Obunsha. And then Obunsha has innovated not only in publishing, but also education industry. And maybe the most biggest topic in this history is the in 1952, they launched the radio broadcasting university entrance prep course. It enabled equivalence of educational opportunity everywhere in Japan. And based on this DNA of Obunsha, our Obunsha Ventures mission would be co-create the future of education. not only in Japan, but also worldwide, we would like to accelerate startups' growth by collaborating with startups and investors and utilizing the assets such as networks, contents, and services developed by Obunsha in its long history. And this is the examples of assets of Obunsha and affiliated company EduLab Wada-san is working. Well, mainly Obunsha has contents, and EduLab has its own e-learning and e-testing assets. And in terms of age groups, basically the target would be from kindergarten to even adults or senior people. Then this is the our front guideline. Investment theme is of course EdTech. And a geographical area will be 70% is focused on domestic, and also 30% is overseas. Especially in the overseas, we Obunsha Ventures is collaborating with EduLab or EduLab Capital Partners, EduLab's the investment arm. And the investment stage will be mainly early stage to middle stage. That's our final guideline. And this is our portfolio so far. There are several investments in our 1.5 year history. And let's move on to what EdTech is from our view. Again, I'd like to present the very simple framework to understand EdTech industry. So first of all, I'd like to define the purpose of education. The purpose of education would be maximizing the value of learners as human resources. And to do that, in terms of how to achieve the purpose of education, would be one is helping learners maximize their potentials and talents. And second, providing them the stages where they perform their best. And I'd like to very summarize very simply the keyword would be mobility. The definition of EdTech, we think, is that the technology to remove barriers preventing mobility in education. And if we can do that, we can vitalize learners' talents and create market or expand EdTech market. And this is a very rough chart of the situation of barriers preventing mobility. The one is barrier preventing skill development. The second one is that barrier preventing matching to stages. And we can break down these two main barriers into mainly four categories. One is, the first one is barriers in skill development and measurement. Second, physical barriers. And third, barriers in information distribution. And finally, barriers in communication with others. So let me explain these subcategories of barriers. The first one is the skill development and measurement. This barrier, interrupt the matching between learners and the place where they learn. Examples barriers would be, for example, class, grade, hierarchy of school, skill gap between new grads and job requirements, or time lag between learning and feedback. And we think EdTech can provide one solution for this barrier to remove, like adapt to learning contents, for example. And the second one is physical barriers. Physical barriers, for example, distance from home to school, capacity of facilities, it's the inefficiency based on being physical. And EdTech can provide a solution like ICT environment, learning management system, AR, VR, e-learning, etc. We can overcome physical barriers through these technological solutions. The third, barriers in information distribution. Even if the learner can develop their skills, if they don't have any information about what they do with the skills, they cannot efficiently utilize their skills. So basically, examples of barriers would be a lack of data related to learning contents, learning demographics, school, company. It will stop the matching between learners and stages. And the examples of EdTech would be a matching platform, a school information site, etc. And this is our investment example for a third one. The company is Education, running in Philippines. And they operate online platforms providing the information about schools and jobs for Generation Z. Generation Z is the the age groups from age 13 to 23. So they realized the matching between the stages and the learners. The last one is communication with others. Well, a lack of communication skills or mental control would prevent mobility because learners couldn't collaborate and complete project with others even if they got enough knowledge. So examples barriers like feeling lonely, quarrel with other team members, lack of motivation, or impatience. And it's a very new area of EdTech, I think. And EdTech are now showing some solutions for that, like social networking, communication apps, or social and emotional learning contents, kind of. And this is examples of our investment. The company is Study Plus. They operate SNS for students. And students can record their own learning accomplishments and be motivated by connecting to and communicating with other users. So finally, I'd like to give you guys a message from us. Let's explore barriers in education and solutions for the future of education together. Thank you very much.
Let's welcome
them. 懂中文的朋友们可以把耳机摘下来了。我是日本贸易振兴机构JETRO北京代表处的金金浩，中国职员。今天呢，非常有幸啊，能参加这个 session 啊，跟大家介绍。 日本政府机构啊，怎么来推进中日之间的贸易投资？特别是在这个创新领域的这种合作和交流。因为呢时间关系啊，我可能讲的比较简单。希望大家呢对这个业务感兴趣的话，可以回头跟我们多多的交流。那么我简单说一下我们这个机构啊，说这个 JETRO 这个标志啊，可能在很多的展会上大家可能看到过。这个机构呢是日本的政府。 专门促进日本和海外之间的这种双向贸易、双向投资的这么一个政府机构，主要做的是促进日本和海外之间的这种这个商务拓展，还有呢外国企业到日本去的投资相关的协助以及智库的功能。这个机构在日本和海外呢，总共有1700多人，120多个代表处。中国这边呢是包括北京、上海、广州在内有8个代表处。接着在中国呢。 现在是有这几个业务板块，一个是我负责的，协助中国企业到日本去，这种这个对日投资的这个相关业务。其他的领域呢，更多的是帮助日本企业，在中国拓展业务，提供各种帮助。这里边包括我们每年呢都会举办像这上面列的消费品啊、老龄产业呀、食品这些领域的几十场的交流会。 同时我们在知识产权创新方面呢，也会进行更多的交流活动。 还有一个我们比较重的一个任务呢，就是帮助在中国的几万家日本企业、日资企业，给他们提供各种帮助。像我们呢，通过各种的问卷调查，还有像中国经济与日本企业这样的白皮书，通过这样的渠道呢，收集各种日本企业的这个需求或者是他们的呼声，向两国政府和社会各界，反映他们的呼声。那么 ，Zetoro 呢，到现在为止，在全球范围内呢，跟进服务了20,000多家的企业到日本去投资，这是其中的一部分。我们在中国这个范围内呢，提供帮助的一些企业，大家可以看到，基本上各个领域都涵盖到，所以可以说呢，在日本呢，这个商机是无处不在。特别是在这个 EdTech 在内的这种创新领域啊，我们觉得中日是这个两个国家的合作领域是非常广泛的。正如刚才和田社长提到的哈，日本的 EdTech 这个市场规模啊，虽然可能没有我们中国这个市场规模这么发展这么快，但是呢，确实也是在这几年呢，以8%的这种速度哈，在不断的扩大。政府呢也是通过各种的措施来推进这个 EdTech 领域的发展，所以呢，我觉得对中国的企业或投资人来说，这个领域也是非常好的一个投资机会。那从我们的机构也是，通过这个走出去啊，或者是引进来这个方式呢，也做了很多的工作。比如呢，在走出去方面，我们通过帮助日本的初创企业，以这种 GIP 项目或者是全球加速基地这样的项目呢，以及带着他们呢参加各种海外的，比如说知名的一些这个展会，给他们提供这个跟国外企业进行对接合作的机会。再比如从引进来这个角度，我们每年呢都会邀请一些有实力的初创企业到日本去参加一些展会，我们也给他们安排一些在日本的孵化器啊、加速器啊或者相关的企业，跟他们进行对接交流。还有一个呢，我们也会帮助国内外的一些初创企业以及孵化器、加速器，这些还有共享空间吧，在日本呢成立网点，帮助他们呢尽快的加入到日本的一些生态圈。那这个呢是刚才前面提到的一个 GIP 的项目，在这个项目呢，有关的路演活动我们在深圳啊、上海举办过多次，每次都吸引了很多的投资人，给这些日本企业在全球的布局提供了一些帮助。这个项目特别适合于在日本呢有一些这个技术独特的技术，还有在日本已经做了一些专利啊、商标这些布局的日本企业，帮助他们呢迅速的找到一些投资方或者是合作方。然后这个呢是刚才提到的全球加速基地这么一个项目，目前呢我们全球有20多个加速基地，联合的 Techstar 啊或者是匠心这样的机构呢，帮助日本初创企业更好的融入当地的这个生态圈，并提供各种信息，包括介绍各种投资人，创业指导、免费的办公空间等等。那么我们在这个 GIP 项目、全球加速基地这个项目甄选的这些企业呢，是在10,000多家这些企业里边精选出来的优秀的企业，所以呢，通过跟这些企业的交流合作，我相信咱们中国的企业呢，也能够尽快的融入到日本当地的一些生态圈，实现一些合营或者多营。借此机会，我也简单介绍一下我们这个机构，全球的120多个代表处呢，怎么帮助赴日投资的一些企业提供这些相关的服务。这里包括一个是前期准备阶段，提供各种信息啊、咨询，包括一些行业的调查报告。公司设立阶段，就是注册阶段呢，我们也会给他们提供各种咨询，包括介绍各种比较可信赖的服务机构。成立公司以后，我们还有一些团队在日本呢，给他们提供各种帮助，帮助他们呢在其他的日本其他的地方成立公司，拓展业务。可以说呢，一旦进入这个Zetoro服务的范围里边的话，企业可以得到一些终身的服务，而且这些服务全都是免费的。具体服务内容呢，因为时间关系我就不展开了。右上角有我们这种网站，这上面有很多的信息，包括一些成功的案例，大家可以参考一下。那么有很多企业呢跟我们说，到底有多少家企业或者什么类型的企业啊在日本成立公司了？那这里边列了一部分的这个中国企业在日本已经在日本落地的 部分企业，比较多，各个行业都有。那借此机会呢，我想请大家呢关注一下日本的两个方面的商机吧。一个呢就是日本的地方。为什么说日本的地方呢？日本有47个都道府县，那这个47个都道府县呢，有很多的地方，它的 GDP， 它的经济实力呢是超过欧洲的一些国家，或者东南亚的一些国家，甚至是几个国家的这个合计，所以呢，经济实力包括消费能力都是比较高的啊。还有一个，我想推荐的是，2004年的时候。我们的主管部门日本经济产业省在日本发布了一个叫 GNT 100这么一个企业名单，也就是说 Global Niche Top 100，就是细分领域的领军企业100家。像这些企业呢，多数是在日本的地方，像他们的市场份额呢，少的是10%，有的是100%，啊，这个市场份额非常大。还有呢，大家经常听到的日本的百年企业，像这样的百年企业呢，日本有30000多家。这些30000多家的多数企业在日本的地方，所以呢，我为什么要提到日本的地方？大家不要只是一提到这个日本呢，就要想到东京。当然，东京有它的优势，包括信息、包括交通各方面哈。但是呢，我们建议大家呢，更多的关注日本地方的一些商机。还有一个就是创新领域、初创企业的一些动向啊，这个也是今天我们的一个主题之一哈 ，EdTech 在内的。那我们看一下这方面呢。我想特别请大家留意一下，这几年呢，就是在这个领域呢，外资的巨头不断的涌进日本的，像物联网啊、金融科技啊、共享服务啊这些领域。这里包括中国的，像这个阿里巴巴的这个支付宝、微信支付，还有滴滴出行等等，他们在内呢是陆续抢滩日本市场。从右边这个能看到，日本很多的这个。创新活动也是不断的在各地举办，还有像 WeWork 啊、亚马逊等等呢，他们也在日本不断的开办一些这种加孵化器或者加速器或者是联合办公空间。这些动向意味着什么呢？就是意味着今后一段时间内，创新或者初创企业是蕴含着大量的商机。因为时间关系呢，我就不再多说了。有对我们这个资料啊，或者是这个信息感兴趣的朋友呢，可以随时跟我们联系。比如我们这边呢有现成的有关 EdTech 的资料，当然可能没有刚才两位这个嘉宾啊介绍这么新哈，但是我们有一些这个报告呢是现成的，比如说帮助大家可以了解到 EdTech 的现在的整体的情况，包括一些细分领域的这种成长性啊，包括哪些竞争企业在里边，哪些平台运营商在里边，还有呢外国企业进入这个 EdTech 领域的现在的目前的情况，还有他们可以考虑的日本的合作伙伴，再一个就是这个领域的资质审批情况，还有各地方的优惠措施啊，相关的行业团体啊、展会啊等等，这种信息都可以通过这种我们现成的一些报告，得到相关的启发吧。感谢邀请我出席本次会议的 EdLab 和田社长，希望和在座的各位呢一起推进中日在 EdTech 在内的各领域的合作，谢谢大家。
All right, thank you all the presenters. I'd like to move on to a panel discussion now. Please, I'd like to invite the presenters up to the stage. Please. So this is the second part of our session where we'd like to drill in more about what their organization's position in terms of EdTech. And I'd like to start off, first of all the panels will be in English, but probably Mr. Kim will answer in Chinese, I guess. Okay, so anyone who needs a translator, put it on, okay? So first of all, I'd like to ask a question to Obunsha Ventures. As we saw, we see a lot of trends fueling the EdTech boom in Japan. And I think myself and the audience are very curious to understand why such a traditional education publisher like Obunsha has created a CVC, Companies Venture Capital, and tackling this EdTech trend? And what's your position and what's the thoughts behind it?
Well, actually, frankly speaking, in Japanese EdTech, the movement is a bit slower than maybe the ones in China or US. And then there are very, very few open innovations. Then as of the ventures, we can connect the Obunsha's assets like contents, networks, brands. It's a very, very sophisticated asset through a long history. But these days, the speed of changing environment, change of environment is very, very fast, and for Obunsha, to follow this, you know, change is a bit difficult by ourselves only. So we strongly feel that we have to collaborate with the other, you know, EdTech companies, which is following the, you know, cutting edge technologies or, you know, the move. The latest movement of education industry, so we can provide the such a, you know, very traditional or sophisticated asset, and we can utilize or how can I say collaborate with cutting edge technology of the EdTech companies. So. In the manner, we believe we can generate, you know, the open innovation in educational field.
Okay, thank you very much. It's from us Japanese, it's very encouraging to see such a traditional historical education big player coming into EdTech, because it's going to definitely accelerate the EdTech speed in Japan. So now, my second question. Goes to Jetro Beijing. As I understand, Jetro Beijing has many experiences regarding Japan, China, innovation, investments, trade accelerations. And I don't know if you have any EdTech experience in terms of bridging EdTech industry, Japan, China. If you do, please do explain about some of the examples. And if you do not have any at this moment, please explain about your thoughts about EdTech, Japan, China.
Thank you. 谢谢。感谢何天授的提问。是这样，就是从我们的角度呢，是不分什么领域来协助的。所以呢，我想介绍一下我们在这个协助中国企业和日本企业啊，在 EdTech 领域在内，合作，包括投资啊、贸易合作的这些领域的一些想法啊。就是大家知道啊，日本企业呢，在若干年前，特别是我们70后啊、60后、50后的这些年龄层的我们的中国的消费者，会记得非常清晰。当时他们的一些产品给我们带来很多的这种惊喜，或者是美好的回忆。但是呢，近些年来，特别是在所谓的这个第四次产业革命到来之际呢，日本在包括这种新的创新方面啊，缺乏一些动力，感觉是这是一个对日本来说是非常大的一个课题。那从这个角度呢，我们日本 Jetro 这个在内各种机构呢，在我们的每年出的就是对日投资报告2018里边，我们也指出来。外资呢，对日本的这个创新啊，是带来很好的一个作用，它能带来新的一些商业模式，可以和日本企业呢共同呢创造一些新的这种价值，同时呢，跟外资合作有利于日本，特别是大企业的一种开放创新啊，同时呢，发挥这个各自的特长，优势互补，在这个过程中，日本企业和海外的企业都能得到这种各自希望得到的一些好处，得到一些实现一些双赢。那么我想这个 Jetro 作为一个合作的桥梁啊，努力促进 EdTech 在内各个领域的合作，它的初衷就在于这里。 还有一点我想补充一下，就是长久以来日本呢作为一个课题解决先进国，它在一些特别特定的一个课题的解决方面，它有非常多的一些先进的经验，包括一些技术啊。那这些技术呢，日本各界正在努力发挥它的一些优势和专长，把现有的一些技术和它的一些经验呢，融入到新的一些产业领域，包括 EdTech 在内啊。那希望结合国外的一些技术啊，他们的一些模式、他们的资金啊、他们的一些网络啊，形成一个有机的生态系统。那在这个过程中，特别是担负人才教育这个重任的教育领域，提高教学和这种教学习的效率，减轻教职员工还有这些学生的负担，为日本今后的持续创新，培养具有创造性思维的这些人才，传承日本的这种课题解决能力，在这方面呢，是日本政府和民间各界都是非常关心也正在努力的这么一个领域。所以日本政府刚才和田社也提到了哈，有很多的文件上明确的提出要发展这个 EdTech， 而且呢通过建立一些他的 PPT 里也提到了叫未来教室和 EdTech 研究会等等这种措施呢，在努力的促进 EdTech 领域的发展。所以在这个领域呢，现在日本各界在迅速响应，这个相关的市场规模啊，刚才也提到了啊，虽然是市场规模扩大的速度没有中国那么大，但是呢，是逐渐的在扩大。所以我觉得，对中国企业来说呢，这个领域是非常好的一个合作机会，进入日本生态的一个很好的机会。所以我建议呢，有成能力的一些企业可以更多的关注这个领域。谢谢大家。
Thank you. So as we all know that any industry to grow, its acceleration and its growth. It's always very important to take in account the factor of cross-border innovation. So I'm very happy to see JETRO coming into this EdTech industry and looking at its role to accelerate this. So, you know, JETRO's role in terms of cross-border innovation in terms of EdTech, it's like an ecosystem. So ecosystem in any industry is very important in its growth. So I'd like to go back to Obunsha and ask, so ecosystem is very important in any industry, and especially like an industry like EdTech, which is still very early stage. So what is Obunsha Ventures' thoughts about how you would like to position in this ecosystem and how you would like to contribute?
I'd like to appeal, Japanese content is very sophisticated with long history, especially in education or media or publishing. But the one problem is that they basically don't know how to access the edutech or, you know, cutting edge technologies. And as I said, the environment is changing very fast, so they would like to follow the trend, or they would like to make open innovation. So from the Obunsha Ventures perspective, we would like to you know, become the bridge between such a so-called legacy industry and edutech or the other, you know, peripheral technologies. So, and also we would like to collaborate with EduLab and other, you know, the partners to, you know, connect them to you know, global market. We believe Japanese edutech or Japanese contents would have power to get, you know, huge market in not only Japanese market, but also the global market. So we would like to be a bridge for, you know, cultivate or explore such kind of, you know, market.
Thank you. Thank you. So I think for the time's sake, this is going to be probably the last question. And I would like to ask JETRO my last question. JETRO Beijing have been a hub and have had many experience in terms of bridging the trade, the companies, and investments. If there's any tips for Japanese company, or maybe here it's better, tip for Chinese companies to come to Japan And from your experience, what would you say would be a tip for them?
好，谢谢您提问。是这样，就是不管是 EdTech 或者其他领域，或者是中国企业到日本去，或者是日本企业来华发展呢，我觉得有几点啊要格外的注意。这个不一定说是这个特别深奥的东西啊。首先一个呢，我们觉得呢，对自己的技术一定要客观的评价。进入一个新的市场呢，有的企业可能觉得自己的这个技术非常强，所以呢，我们建议呢，就是进入一个新的市场，一定要做市场调研。这个可能要花点时间，花点钱，但是这个是必须的一个流过程。再一个就是，日本企业来中国市场发展的时候，我建议呢，要加快他们的节奏，这个适应中国的节奏。那同时，咱们中国的企业到日本去发展的时候，又要适应他们的节奏，要理解他们的这种决策程序或者是他们的思维模式。第三个呢，就是知识产权的保护，这个是必须要做的。但说实话，最关键的还是自己要有一个非常非常这个核心的，不怕模仿的这么一个东西，核心的东西，这才是关键的。第四个呢，就是单独进入一个新的市场，我觉得还是比较困难的，特别是中国企业到日本去投资啊。我觉得是建议尽快的找到合作伙伴，像今天在座的像 Obunsha 呀，或者是 EdLab 这样的这些优秀的企业，可以跟他们合作，共同开发市场。谢谢大家。
Thank you. And this is it for all. Please round of applause for all the presenters presenter today, and also to you, good audiences. Thank you. Sorry, I wanted to have a Q&A session, but for the time's sake. So if you have any questions, please do contact any of the speakers after this session. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
本环节到此结束，请有序退场。